Chapter 3. How does the traction motor work? In this chapter, we will take the equations from chapter 2 and we will look where we can find them inside the machine, so to understand how does the motor work. So let's have first a look at the motor itself. How does a typical traction motor look like? And of which parts does he consist? So, typically, there is a stator. So this is the non-rotating part. And the stator consists of the stator core, which is basically made of iron sheets. So there is a lamination, and there are many iron sheets put together when they form the stator core. And also in the stator, there is the stator winding. You can see here the winding heads, but they go through the stator core and then on the other hand they go back. And through the stator winding the current will flow. This is the non-rotating part of the machine, together with the end shields on both sides. Inside we have the rotor. Of course the rotor is the rotating part, and the rotor consists also of magnetic steel sheet and of conductors inside the rotor. And in a few minutes we will see how it looks like exactly. So let's go back to the stator. Here you have a section of the core, of the stator core. And in the stator core, on the first side, we now take one coil. So here we have one coil which goes through the slot, then changes its direction, and then goes back through another slot and comes back here. And so we use the coil to conduct the current, the stator current. And the first law which we come across is Ohm's law. Unfortunately, it tells us that every time we have a current here in this conductor, that we also will have losses. And these losses are called the copper losses. And as you can see from the equations, they are related to the material, so to the resistance of the material, and they are related to the square of the current. So the higher the current, and to the square, the higher are the losses inside the conductor. But there's something else going on when we have a current. If we remember, then every time you have a current, then this current produces a magnetic field around him. So, if we put the current here through the conductor, then as a result, we will get a magnetic field. So we will get the magnetic flux, and the magnetic flux will primarily go through the magnetic sheets, as we will see later. And we do something else. Typically, in the coil, we will not make only one winding, but we make a certain number of windings, and so we multiply the current, and then we get a stronger magnetic field. And, as I already mentioned, also the material is important. And so here we see a cross-section. Again, we have the coil with the current, now in this direction. And in orange you see the magnetic flux lines. And now you see that these magnetic flux lines, because of the material property, the high permeability of the magnetic steel sheet, The magnetic flux goes through the magnetic sheet. It does not go through the cooling ducts, which consist of air, and it also does not go through the slots. The slots itself, they consist of air, and in the slots there are the conductors, which are made of copper, and they also have a low permeability. So the flux basically goes only in the magnetic steel sheet. And the magnetic flux always forms a closed loop. So it goes here through the stator sheet, and then, because the stator sheet is formed like this, it wants to go through this part of the machine. And usually, in this part of the machine, there is the rotor. And so in the rotor, in green color, you also have electric steel sheet. And so the flux can easily go through the rotor and then crosses the air gap, goes back to the stator. On the right side, you see a finite element calculation of the flux density. What is important about that is that you must be very careful when you design a machine that the flux has enough space in the electric steel sheet. So for example here, between the slot and between the cooling duct, there's not much space, and here the saturation of the magnetic flux becomes quite high. And also you see it here in the tooth tip, so at the end of the tooth, that the magnetic flux density is quite high. So in the first step, we saw that by Ampere's law, a stator current results in a magnetic flux. And now this magnetic flux goes through the rotor. So it enters the rotor somewhere, and then it goes back to the stator. And we have another equation. It's the Maxwell-Faraday equation. And basically, the Maxwell-Faraday equation tells us that in a magnetic field can also result in an electric field. But there is the time derivative, what is important here. So only a change in the magnetic flux results in an electric field. Or, in other words, only if we change the flux here, then we will have a voltage induced here in the conductors in the rotor bars. So, how can we realize that? That we move the magnetic flux in respect to the rotor. This we will see in chapter 3a. Let's have a look now at the rotor, how it is built. So, inside the rotor slots of the rotor lamination, there are copper bars. And at the end, all the copper bars are connected by short circuit rings. So, there are the copper bars, and there are the short circuit rings, and they together form the squirrel cage. And this is already the complete structure of the rotor of an induction machine. So it's quite simple, and that's why it's also so successful. So let's continue now to understand how the electrical machine works. We already know that we need a magnetic field which changes in time. And from chapter 3a, we already know how to realize that. So, now the magnetic flux changes in space and time a voltage is induced in the short circuit bars. And as a result of the voltage, a current flows. Until now we used Ampere's law, so that the current in the stator results in a magnetic field, and the magnetic field then goes from the stator to the rotor. After that we used Faraday's law of induction to explain that a magnetic field, and especially a magnetic field with changes in time, results in a voltage and therefore a current in the rotor bars. And finally, we now use this third equation from chapter 2, which is the Lorentz force. And the Lorentz force tells us that if we have a current, in this case a current in our rotor bars, and if we have a magnetic field, in this case it's the magnetic field coming from the stator to the rotor, and they together, they produce a force. And this force results in a torque of the electric machine. So basically we can understand now how the induction machine works. There's one thing to emphasize about the induction machine, and that's the fact that according to Faraday's law of induction, you always need a difference in speed between the rotating field produced by the stator and the rotational speed of the rotor to produce a torque. If there is no difference between the rotational speed of the stator field and the rotation of the rotor, that means that the rotor is rotating with the same speed as the stator field, then no torque is produced in the induction machine. And that leads us to the definition of the slip. So the slip of the induction machine is defined as the difference between the rotating speed of the rotor, so the physical rotating speed, and the rotating speed of the field of the stator, so the speed of the electromagnetic field. And this difference in relation to the speed of the field is called the slip of the induction machine. That means if the speed of the rotating field and the speed of the rotor is the same, the slip is zero and no torque is produced. If this difference now increases, then also the slip increases from zero to a certain value. We can now take a look at the diagram, which shows us how the induction machine is usually used. So, on the horizontal axis, you can see the speed. And the speed is written down in two different ways. So on the one hand, you really have the speed of the machine, so the speed here is zero, and here it increases and increases until here the nominal speed is reached. And on the other hand, you can use the slip to describe the speed of the machine. So we already know that when the rotor speed is the same as the speed of the field, then this is the nominal point, and then this the nominal speed, and then the slip is zero. So here the slip is zero. And when the difference between the rotor speed and the speed of the field becomes larger and larger, then also the slip increases, and finally at standstill of the machine, the slip is one. So the speed here is zero, and the speed here is the nominal speed, and on the contrary, the slip here is zero and slip here is one. So How do you usually use the induction machine? Of course, you want to produce a torque. And so you must use a slip which is not equal to zero. But you see something interesting here. If you look at the torque in green, you can see the torque curve. So if you increase the slip, at first the torque increases. But then after some time you reach the maximum torque. And after that, if you increase the slip, the torque already decreases. So there is one point, the maximum torque, where the machine has a certain slip and can produce the maximum torque. So typically you use the machine in the range between a slip of zero and somewhere here before you reach the maximum torque. You can see one reason why you should not operate the machine in the range on the left side of the maximum torque. And this is just have a look at the power consumption of the machine. In pink you see the electrical power, so this is the power you must feed to the machine. And in blue you see the mechanical power, so this is the mechanical power you get out of the machine. And here there is a huge difference. So that means the difference between the electrical power and the mechanical power, it's all losses. A modern traction machine is always used together with electronic power converters. So that means that you can change the frequency of the magnetic field. So you can change the frequency of the rotating field, and that also means that you can shift this point here. So if you want to go from a low speed to a higher speed, you change the frequency of the rotating field, and by this you just shift the whole curve, and so you get the region where the torque is constant, the maximum torque is constant. And this maximum torque is constant as long as you can increase the voltage in the same way as you increase the speed. But after some time, if you increase the speed, you reach the voltage limit of the converter. And then you cannot increase the voltage anymore, but you must increase the speed if you want to go to a higher speed. And so this proportion does not keep constant anymore. Which means that the maximum torque goes down. And so there is a region where you have constant power, limited by the power of the converter, and finally a range where the torque or the maximum torque is proportional to the speed. So basically we can understand now how an induction machine for railway application works. So on the one hand, the principle that of an induction machine generally, that there must be a difference between the rotating speed of the rotor and the rotating speed of the electromagnetic field in order to produce a torque. And secondly, you usually use power electronics to control the speed and therefore the frequency of the electromagnetic field in the stator. That's the end of chapter 3 about the induction machine.